Now, so that's it. So it's recording. So we now our conversation will just go into if we hate this, we'll delete it. If we love it, we'll keep it, share it.
All
Okay.
right, sounds
All right, I'm
good.
gonna toggle back and forth. You guys can see, so you can see who I am, see if it'll do it. Good morning. And
All right, how's it going, man?
I
All
got
right.
my best friend and guru and Sifu, Ron Kosakowski, on the other side of the screen here. And anyway, we haven't talked in a long time, so we were catching up off camera. Now we're on camera. You were just telling me about your mountain biking adventure. I've got a list of things I want to chat with you that are there's some pretty interesting points I think people would want to know about. But you were just talking about mountain biking. We can pick that back up. You feel sore after the ride?
Oh yeah, I mean, like I said, I haven't rode since I was like 13 years old, and bikes are completely different. This thing had all kinds of sophisticated equipment on it, and, hydraulic brakes, which I didn't even know bikes had that. I thought it was just motorcycles.
Yeah.
I mean, it has shocks that really, I went over some rocks that, you could, it didn't even feel it. It was amazing. I said, "Oh my God, my ass is going to be killing me here." And I stood up and I braced myself. And I said, "Wow, I didn't even feel that. I thought I was going to feel it in my elbow."
That's
And
funny.
I mean, it was amazing.
That's
It was just amazing. I just, I, my legs when I got off the thing, which I had to get off like around this area where I was riding. It's out in Beacon Falls here, some reservoir way out in the middle of nowhere. There's like four reservoirs there. And I'll tell you, I had to get off like four times because I couldn't even handle it. I was just like, wow. I've been doing some, quintile positioning. That's basically where I'm at. But I've been doing quintile positioning for, 40 something years. So
Yeah.
if I don't get the workout, I actually get bored by myself doing it. But this was a whole different area.
It's exciting. New hobbies can put you back to the place where you're a beginner again. And
Oh yeah.
and
Oh
you've
yeah.
got the probably you're probably the ultimate student with the amount of years you've got training. When you see something brand new, you have just that laugh and that great time you're having when you're saying, "Man, I'm no good at this. I just did this. I'm okay, but man, I'm feeling it. I can you know what I mean? I can understand how people are so good at this, but I'm not." You know what I mean? When you see a great martial artist do something, you're like, "What did they do? What is that? Do that again. Do that again." I'm sure like the biking experience was like that, I'm sure.
Yeah, well, John told me, he said he met people that are well into their 70s that are still doing bike rides and they're riding, around trails that, probably would kill me right now, But John also said when he comes to the quintile class, he can't, his legs are killing him when he's doing the positioning.
Yeah.
So, catch 22 on
There's
that,
a difference in muscles where you're standing still and you're not moving at all. And you've got moments where, your weight now is on you. And that is a different muscle group than if you're just sitting there striking a pedal and pushing and,
Oh
pivoting. It's a total different experience.
Well, there's different ways to do it, and I kind of modified it with kettlebells too. So we sit in a very low position,
Yeah.
and we do different ways to do it. You sit there with no stuff. The traditional way is to actually hold your arms out like this. I don't know if you can see me, but
Yeah.
That's the traditional way. You sit in a wide, some people call it horse stance. We never called it that, actually.
It's
And
just the
then you
double
face the
wide,
left
right?
and then you face the right. Now, you could do that same exercise with, just squatting up and down, getting a very low position, like, sitting, going back up to position, sitting, going back up to position. And you do that for a long time. And I modified that by stationary positions and the squatting down and up again in all three positions with a kettlebell. So
Yeah,
that I
that's a good
found
workout.
it kills, like takes away a lot of the time off of the workout by, burning your legs.
Yeah.
And it really works well. I found also as you do the kettlebells for a long time with that, the quintile positioning, that you put the kettlebells down, all of a sudden it's like using a new muscle without the kettlebells again. I found that fascinating.
You feel it. It's interesting.
This comes by one of my black belts, Frank.
Yeah.
It goes like this, try it without the kettlebells. And he did it. And everybody was like, oh, my God, I can't take it. You know?
I remember like, those years when
a whole new muscle again.
Yeah, when kettlebells first came out, you picked up a big supply, and it was a big part of your routine. I've got one here under my desk that I use here and there. But I've got my three-year-old, so I pick him up and do – you know, stance work and things with him.
Yeah,
and I can remember when I first met you, Jesse was 4 years old. So we want to go back in time and know how I know you. I was your student. So I've been through some of that. I remember when the kettlebells came around. I remember when Jesse was climbing you as a part of some of his grappling abilities. And so any kind of weight, I remember you standing there, you know, nice and strong. And him climbing you and trying to go around and then you know you have to do that twice and go up the pole the up reverse.
Yeah,
it's cool. It's cool how weight training has happened. In the cycle here of our training, I remember when kettlebells first came out; they're amazing.
Yeah,
they've really become like a fixture of a lot of gyms, and I really enjoyed the general swing and lift and play with the gravity and that's pretty much all I do with it, but I've seen people do get-ups, and I've seen some Chinese masters take this big stone block, they take it, they throw it, they catch it, and they're asking for broken toes, but it's really cool.
I do that with a weight. Now, Joe Ross used to have us do something like that, is like throw something up and then catch it.
Mm.
And we used to do it with different things. I remember when he showed it to us outside one time, he showed us that it was at a picnic. When I first saw it, we had with our Kuntal class, and he was doing it with a rock. And I started doing that, and I was like, wow, that really burned out my forearm.
Yeah, like an old Kamna exercise.
I know. Now we do it with a 25-pound weight. Yeah. You know, just throw it up and catch it. Throw it up and then catch it. You know, and then I kind of snag it. And I noticed, you know, gripping, especially in Kuntal, or any grappling system, you might say, you know, it enhances. It just enhanced my, you know, grip in the body, you know, being able to get in there, grabbing an arm, grabbing the back of the head, you know, or grabbing somebody's hair, you know, or jawbone with the eye, face, you know, area, you know, it enhances all that.
You get that grip going, you really are in a different level. I had that grip for a really short time. I was doing training with you for Kali, and I was doing judo and Wing Chun years ago. And I can remember, especially you noticed it when you were doing gi grappling, if your grip lasted for the whole class, you'd arrived.
I know, yeah.
And then Kali, if you didn't, you know what I mean? If you weren't that guy who just kept dropping his stick because your hand kept giving away, you were doing good.
Yeah.
It took a while to build it up. I know I don't have that grip now. Are you still doing, you doing any solo work to like Karenzas or anything to kind of keep your Kali play? When you walk, do you take a stick with you and stuff?
No, I don't take a stick with on the walks. I'm just holding the dog. I'm using grippers, right now just to try to burn the forearms out. And then I found you do a tug of war with the dog, you know, 115 pounds of muscle trying to pull while I'm trying to, after I do the grips and talk about forearm grip, burnout, I could usually contend with them, but after I do the workout, it's kind of a weird workout. But, you know, he won't give up on the tug of war. So
I know. You know, it's interesting right now because of life situations is that really we're going to learn who has the discipline and who can take their martial art and just functionalize it and apply it in their everyday life, like playing with your dog or working a grip or knowing that you don't want to lose your grip for certain reasons. And without the classroom.
Indian Gada. I've been doing movements. Like just basically one and two angles. Sometimes the four gate, I'll do coming up this way and just come down and then back up again. And I do that and just for a warm up, I do it my left and my right side. A few other things to warm up and then I'll do the Indian Gada. You know, I do the shoveling with it first because I'll tell you, can't just go into, you know, 10 to 2s and full swings with the Indian Gada until you, you warm the body up, especially at my age. I mean, it'd be stupid to, you know, wreck something on my body.
You want to get your engine on before you start really charging hard. That's just wisdom, you know. Listen, I know we're rambling and we're kind of letting our conversation flow, but I've actually got some key things that I said to myself. If I ever get a chance to interview you, I've got some key questions or topics I want to raise. And in light of some really big news, I want to go back into history. And the big news is that, you know, the UFC is saying they want to keep their empire running. So they're going to buy an island and, like, straight out of Enter the Dragon, they're going to go have their event and let these fighters do their things. I'm really excited for the Tony Ferguson fight with Khabib. I know that fell through. Yeah. That would have been really, that would have been really fun to watch. Let's go back in time to the early days of the UFC, because I know you've got a history with the Gracies. I've seen photos that were decorated all over your gym of you with the very, very young Royce Gracie and the other fellas that I couldn't name. I only know a couple of them. And you could name, and you could give us some,
just Orion, Hickson.
Yeah.
Helson was one a guy that, you know, I liked working with. He was very street oriented. I liked the way he taught, you know.
Yeah. Now you came from a Kung Tao background, and then you came into Jeet Kune Do, and then you're now searching for, you know, the truth in martial arts in that vein of jiu-jitsu. And tell me how you found the Gracies. Tell me how that all happened.
Actually, I think it was around 1989. I saw them in a magazine.
Okay.
And I said, I got to go see them. And I got to see who they are. And they're putting out this challenge also. I think it was prior to their $100,000 challenge I saw that. But they were willing to fight anybody, I remember. And I said, I got to see what this is about, you know. And my grappling was with, you know, Larry Hartzell, you know, still. So really, grappling was pretty much, if you weren't already a wrestler or doing judo, grappling wasn't very popular. But among us in Jeet Kune Do, say, for example, if that were under, I would say early on was like Dan Anasanto and Larry Hartzell.
Yeah.
We had some grappling. Back in the 80s, I was only seminar training with them. So it wasn't as sophisticated as going out and, you know, training with them, which I did later on in the early 90s. I started going, you know, visiting Larry Hartzell, you know, so spending, having him come to the school, having him do private lessons. We used to do private lessons on, because he came down for a weekend seminar. I used to do private lessons on a Friday, and then on a Monday, then he'd fly home that Monday night.
And people need to understand that if you get private time with these greats and you touch hands with them, you know, you're getting deep, deep, rich knowledge, immediate corrections. If you touch hands with a guru or a sensei or a high, high level master in any craft, if you touch hands with them, you're going to absorb that skill so fast in a private one-on-one environment.
Yeah.
No contest. So what I'm curious about is some of the great stories. You shared one. Now, you used to be a stunt driver and you were on way to seminar. You had literally Gracie family members in the truck.
Tell us that
story, could you? Because I crack up. I love that stuff.
Okay, that was funny, actually. Actually, I just saw Hoist at one of the Bellator fights, and I brought that up, and he started laughing.
That's awesome. Tell me.
And what had happened is, for some reason, my muffler fell off, peeled my tire, literally like an orange, just peeled it. It grabbed onto the muffler. We're probably doing 60, 65 miles an hour. It took the muffler and sent it flying right through the floor. Incidentally, right where Hoist was laying in the back of my van. I had a van back then. And right through the back of the van. But the thing is, his head was laying on his workout bag. And it just, like, the pressure of it went right through the floor and pushed him forward.
Oh.
And all of a sudden, I'm going, and he's flying forward. I'm all over the highway now because the back tire is blown.
Jesus.
And I remember seeing a car next to me. I'm trying to avoid that. You don't have good control on three tires.
Yeah, holy.
Trying to avoid the car in front of me. I went in between another car. I remember this was like crazy. And this all happened within, I think, 1 second. I'm not sure. But it might have been 10 seconds. But
sure.
I don't know. I pulled over. And I remember I'm sitting there with my hands on the tire. When I pulled on the steering wheel, and I'm sitting there staring forward, and Horian slaps my shoulder and he goes, "Good driving, man."
No, you guys were on your way to a seminar.
Such a state of shock, and I go, I looked at him, I go, thanks. I better go get help. He had a seminar to get to.
Yes. Oh, that's too funny. That's too funny. You could have wiped out the whole Gracie clan before they ever got famous enough, huh?
I know.
Was this now, if you can go to circle around to UFC, because that puts you as a pioneer. You literally have the Gracie family in your van. You're that close with them, I would say, at least to some level. And now, tell me, where was that in the timeline? When around the early UFC fights were happening, and Hoist, who you probably knew, was there. There he is, all young in his gi, and out in the ring. No one's wearing gloves. Tell me about some of those early days, because you must have seen some stuff nobody else saw.
Well, I started holding the Gracie family at the school when I went out to visit them, and then I went to a seminar in New York City, or was it? I don't know, in that order, I think. And what had happened is I then went to had them for seminars. So I was having Paul Gunak, I was having Larry Hartzell, the Gracie family.
Yeah.
I had a few smaller time people also back then in seminars just to learn martial arts. But so I started, I think it was around 1990 with the seminars, and then Horian had the idea one day, and I think I was at the Gracie Academy, and he was talking to me about it, and he said, we're going to do, we're going to get this thing going. Now, this is in 1992, I think, when he talked about the UFC. I thought it was a great idea. I did not think anybody could get that going. Because
it was massively violent.
Was so big.
Yeah.
And it was bare knuckle fighting. I said, it sounds cool, but I don't think it'll ever get big.
It was no hold bars, right? Or Vale Tudo was some of the early naming?
Yeah, that was down in Brazil. They call it Vale Tudo.
Okay.
And
here was no holds barred.
I guess the Shuto fighting was going on. Eric was fighting for them back then. Ken Shamrock was it was, because Ken Shamrock came from the Shuto fighting that they had going on in Japan into the UFC. So it was going on prior to that. So they did have things like that already going on. But I thought in the United States, I'm like, I liked it. Like I said, I didn't know if it was going to get big. After that first fight they had, I was like, this is going to be big. But back around 92, he asked me if I wanted to invest in it, and I invested. And, it worked out. It worked out well, for a while. And then all these politicians were getting in there saying, oh, this is animalistic fighting. And, I don't want to name off any politicians to insult anybody, but there was one in particular who was a big football fan and a big boxing fan, and he was totally against, the fighting, and thought it was just an animalistic thing. Now, admittedly, having three fights and you're exhausted, and throwing somebody who's fresh in there, that because the guy that was going, you were supposed to fight, as you go down the line, throwing in a fresh body against the guy who just did, two fights.
It was like that, where
that's a little insane.
Yeah. So they would fight, not to interrupt you, but so they would fight, more than one fight in a night, and they would do like an elimination style and go down that way. That's crazy.
Sometimes the elimination, when it came down to it, and now especially in the championship, the guy was fresh. And if the guy that you were supposed to fight was injured in his last fight, I think even Hoist couldn't fight in one of them, if I'm not mistaken. We're going back a while, so I could be off.
They didn't have it. Yeah, it wasn't as well sanctioned and organized and divvied up. Now they have gloves. Now they have rules to keep the fighters safe.
Dana White did it perfect. I mean, he put on the small gloves. It's more to protect your own hands because, like what Keith Hackney broke his own hand. There's other guys that broke their hands, too.
I've seen a lot of them, yeah.
So bare knuckle is good, but you do need some sort of hand protection if you want to keep going in the sport, and it is a sport. Everybody says, well, it's not a street fight. Well, of course it's not a street fight. Neither is basketball. you know, but, you know, it's a sport, you know?
Yeah.
So you gotta, you know, you gotta have the athletes, you know, healthy for their next fight, which is bad enough. My son, for example, you know, he's on probably his 10th fight between amateur and pro.
Yeah.
So, you know, and he's been injured probably in a good, you know, 7 of those fights, you know, right after the fight. And, you know, it's just something he had to rest up, you know, that's all. So, you know, waiting 2 months to, you know, to the next fight, you could do that on the normal injuries that you usually get, depending on how bad it is.
Just training injuries you can recover from in a couple of months.
Injuries you get in the fight. Like, he's hurt his shoulder.
Yeah.
In one of his fights. He fought one of his fights. His last amateur fight was, he was sick, and he injured his shoulder, I think, doing a takedown. I looked over that video. I can't see where he did it, but he did, you know, he went in. I could see that it's possible.
Well, these guys are going full steam, man. I mean, it's just you're two bulls charging, and if one guy twists hard and puts his whole body weight behind it, you could be in an unbelievable place where you get.
It could easily happen, yes. You get
ripped up quick, so I give him credit.
You do need the time. You do need to, you got to wait in between fights. You can't fight one fight after another.
Yeah.
It doesn't prove anything how tough you are or anything like that. It just shows that if the other guy's, you know, injured and you get a fresh body, what does that show? You know what I mean? It's
Yeah.
A lot of the martial artists win, you know, got a UFC championship.
Yeah.
And they really weren't that good, but they just went in fresh against an exhausted body, you know?
Yeah,
you can't do it.
It's not a good measure. It's not a good measure of a person's ability if they're going in against fresh people. So I like the idea of one fight, but it does make it difficult for Jesse and for anybody in the professional leagues even before now, that was trying to schedule their year and plan their routines. And so Jesse's got a great work ethic. You've got him on a great program. Weekly, he knows exactly what he's doing, strength, stretching, you know, reflexes, bag work, et cetera, the nutrition. These guys, but they gear up for a battle, and then hopefully it happens, and then maybe it does, maybe it doesn't. I know that's always a big concern. He was about to get a fight with one of the Gracie offspring there. I would have loved to see that. What was your thoughts on that?
Well, they didn't take the fight, so...
Should we call him?
I don't know why, but, you know, I thought for sure they would, but they didn't take the fight. There's a few people that I thought would take the fight, and they didn't take the last fight. But doesn't look like it would have went on anyway, because by the time that was coming up, I think it was before the virus came in. So I don't know what to say on that. You know,
hypothetically,
maybe in the future he'll be able to fight me. You know?
I'm independent and I can look at it from the outside. But hypothetically, that's a big risky fight for that kid who's trying to build a name. And I think he'd have a really hard time grappling Jesse. I think he'd lose. So that's one thing. It'd be a big battle, and there's a very low percentage that Gracie fella would come out on top, versus you know who. I think, you know, strategically they're all looking at you know, what's my next play, who should I fight, who's the next guy, what, you know, they're trying to rack up wins until they get good enough, and they're all still training, they're all still growing.
Yeah, that's what it is. It's a game like that. So I actually understand it. I'm not saying he's a pussy or anything like that. It's actually the fact that they're trying to rack up their wins. They're trying to pick and choose to get the numbers, get over that 12 fight hump, and then once you get over that hump, it's, you know, you got to fight who the next guy is in line, you know, because it is a process of eliminating, you know, so you know, you're going to have no choice once you get up there, you know.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you know, all the people that did back down, you know, in his amateur fights and in his early pro career, they, you know, they'll all meet in the future if they keep going, you know.
Of course.
I'm not even worried about it, you know.
Yeah.
We're not picking and choosing so much because I'm confident in what I teach him, you know. But, you know, his manager is doing that. So his manager is playing it real smart. I mean, the name of the management is Chess Moves. So I can see what he's doing. So that's cool. You know, get Jesse over that 12 fight hump in his pro career, and then things will start happening. It'll flow better, I think. Right now, it's a pain in the ass.
Yeah,
you know.
I know Carlos, right? Is his first name?
Yeah, Carlos Correa. Yeah, he's a friend and our manager, and You know, he helps out. Even helps out on our fights that we hold at the school. The one we can get them back again.
Yeah, we've met. We'll have to tag him in the end of this video when we publish this. We'll give a little shout out to him and what he's up to. Anybody that's involved in your organizations is a good person to me. So
yeah,
you're a good judge of character. Let's go down into some of my other things. So thank you for sharing some of that history on your role or your experience around the early UFC. I think that's really great to get your perspective. And of course,
I didn't finish about the investment. Let me just.
I'd love to know more about that because that's still a really great topic.
Torian called me one day when they were outlawing the UFC. And he says, I'm selling my stock. I recommend you do it, too, because they're going to outlaw it. And I made a lousy $15,000 because I sold out.
Ah.
It's one of my biggest regrets.
I wonder these guys.
I didn't make myself a backyard over it, but it's one of my biggest regrets.
And so you sold out. You had some shares, 15 grand. You had some money invested.
That's the profit, but it was a nice check at the time, but right now it would have been probably $15 million if I stuck with it.
I know it.
It would have been like investing in Google back in probably 1994 and what it would be now. You know what I mean?
I hear it.
If not more, but that's big. UFC people's grandmothers know the fighters' names in UFC. You know?
Yeah. So right now, people are finding it hard to actually train because they can't get to the gym. They can't get their training partners. Yeah, they're all doing solo training. And to my point before, we're really going to find out who's got discipline when this is all through and we can go back to everything. Who really does their homework, right?
That's
what's going to make or break a lot of these folks. I wonder about the future of the competitions and just how that'll happen. I've got a friend or somebody that I found out about dealing with the WWE, and they're going to open, but they have their sets, and so they've got their stage, they're going to do some backdrops, and they're going to film. They've basically set up a film where the guys train, and they're going to let them do their whole performances and all their pieces. They're going to film it and then still broadcast it. I understand they're doing episodes, but there's no audience. I'm going to call that out. I'm going to say that's probably going to happen for a while, and we might see that that's the way that they're going to have these fights happen. We were at a CES fight last few fights, and the crowd is kind of like on the ground level, and the stage is there in the middle, and it's a lot of lights, and there's great camera work. There's cameramans on every corner. You can know they're broadcasting it. But it's pretty low tech otherwise. You're just like in a big room. I see that, but just with none of the people and maybe just the camera crew and just the fighters and their camps. I think that'd be kind of fun because you're going to get a different experience out of the fighter when there's no crowd. Don't you think?
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be difficult because if there's no crowd and they're going that far, that means martial arts schools are going to have a hard time. So the gym, am I going to fill the gym back up full of fighters again? That's the thing. You know, not only that, I mean, I built that university there and am I going to get all the other classes filled? I wonder what it's going to be like if everything's going to change, you know?
Yeah. I'm
kind of concerned about the future of all this. Now I have to have a gym for Jesse to train, and basically, he was my big incentive to do this whole thing that I did at that gym at that school, school/gym, I call it.
Yeah.
So, there's a concern here. So, I just hope it gets back to normal. Can they kill? If they could cure it, everything will probably go back to normal again. I'd say at least close to it.
Yeah. That's tough. In the meantime, maybe the camps will get tight and short and really heavily concentrated, but you've been grooming Jesse since he was a tiny little guy and he just took a love for it. I remember. And making you proud and just being there and walking through all the people in the gym. Could you tell us a little bit about like his grappling history and some of the great experiences of him showcasing your teaching in a clone of yourself? Can you explain that? Can you go through some of that with us?
Well, I mean, he had it made. When I was grappling a lot, there weren't all these tournaments around. And if they were around, they were far, So I really wasn't getting involved in tournaments all that much, and by the time the tournaments happened, geez, I was already 40 years old at the time, So, I even did a fight, crippled with my knee. I had gotten a month and a half before my new knee was put in. So, I mean, it was kind of crazy and I was 40 years old. So Jesse has it made. All the kids now have it made. They've got a, I'll tell you, there's a tournament every week now if you wanted to.
Yeah.
Somewhere within a state away, you know, so yeah. It's easy to get to. You know, even back when Jesse was first started, it was only what the heck is his name? Kip Kohler's fights there. The just like getting, but I got a brain freeze right now.
Kip Kohler, what's his organization? I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. Just, I can't think of the organization that's really big, and I can't even think of it.
I know that you for a long time you had him going to circuit after circuit, and those of us in the gym, we were all rooting for you guys. Were, you know, the instructors there and the other guys that were there regular. And we'd be like, yeah, Jesse's fight is this. When are you going to put the video up? And then the video would come out, and I swear to God, I learned so much by watching him in all of his actual competition matches. I mean, he goes against – it's like when you go to roll in a classroom and you don't know who the guy is, and he just goes real hard all of a sudden. Now you're really down to skill.
Yeah, he's got like probably well over 60 – videos. I never counted them, but I'll bet you there's somewhere between 60 and 70 fights online. Might even be more.
Wow.
You know, because I brought him, since he was 8 years old, I brought him to tournaments. I mean, probably at least one a month. Sometimes we went to more.
Nice.
We traveled down as far as Georgia to bring him to tournaments. Southern New Jersey, you know, New Jersey doesn't look far on the map, but, you know, some of those were like 5 to 7 hours away, you know, driving just to bring him down there and come back with a trophy, you know.
Yeah.
So, you know, while he was young, that was good. When he got a little older, I think Giancarlo started holding fights, so that was good. Like, you know, I had him, I think Jesse was 10 years old in one of Giancarlo's fights. He started off with boxing there. Then he started doing kickboxing and started doing other kickboxing matches here and there. And, you know, then he did some amateur fights, you know, with the MMA when he got 18 years old. So he's got a lot of experience under him, a lot of experience that a lot of kids don't have. You know, a lot of these fighters that he's fighting might have started at 21 years old, you know, and
they're just
that's
tough.
Why they're having a hard time beating him, you know.
Tell me, if you could give wisdom to an aspiring mixed martial art enthusiast or a younger teenager who's like, man, I really want that. I want to train like that. What tips would you give them now when they don't have a gym yet? Could they learn anything? Like, I would say to everybody, go to your website. I'm going to plug you now, psdtc.com, psdtc.com, or Practical Self-Defense Training Center. You search them on Google. You've got a library of information, of reading literature, and certainly if you go to YouTube, you're going to see a ton of video on all of what you've been doing for so long. But what would you give? I would invite everybody that's listening to this, go and start searching. And of course, you can look at the libraries that are out there. But what advice would you give them? Fitness, right? Fitness, nutrition. Tell us, what would you do?
This is the thing. When there's a martial artist that goes 2 to 3 days a week, does an hour and a half class, then goes home. That's the average person.
Okay.
You know, some people are very happy with that. They got a workout. They got enough for self-defense if they ever need it. Most of them never need it, but, you know, hey, you know, it's something.
They probably don't train at home.
They're learning a skill. They're learning, at my school, they're learning a little bit about the history and the culture, especially in the Filipino martial arts. So, you know, I've been there so much, so I do give them that idea, giving back to the country my martial arts comes from. And then there's the fighters, okay? There's a priority to take there. Now, young kids, they want to get the girls, they want to get drunk, they want to get high, they want to do, I mean, I was like that. I mean, you know, I wanted to party when I was a kid, you know what I mean? I still was doing martial arts even while I was partying. They didn't have all these opportunities and somebody to guide me towards fights either, you know, back then.
I think that's so, okay to party, you know, but for the work ethic.
That's just the way of growing up. However, growing up in the fight world is a different world. You know, it's something you got to have discipline. You got to have priorities. You got to say, this is what I want to do. I got to say, I think right now, 3 to 4 people that are doing exactly that. They make it a priority no matter what.
Yeah.
I have these guys going, coming in and go, oh, I worked all night. I slept. I didn't sleep last night, but I'm still here. That's what I want to hear. You know what I mean? It's like, I don't want an excuse. Well, I couldn't make it because of my girlfriend. I couldn't make it because there was a party last night. You know, it's like, you got a fight coming up. That guy is training to kick your ass.
Yeah.
And beat you and look good doing it. He'd spit on your body if he could to make himself look good. You know, so, you know, if you want to spit on his body, you know, you better train just as hard as he's training.
Yeah.
And that's the bottom line. And there's a, like I said, you want to learn the martial arts, you could come to my school, you could learn the art of Jeet Kune Do. I could do that. You know, of course.
Yeah.
My Jeet Kune Do class isn't only about fighting. However, the fighters do the class so they could learn the science of fighting. Because without the science of fighting, you can't fight. I mean, how are you going to do this? You're just going to swing hands anyway, which way you can?
No,
it's not about conditioning and beating up the bag and hitting the mitts in a pattern. That's not what it's about. You have to learn. There's a science. There's a reason why they call it martial art.
Yeah.
The martial art gives you an edge. If you train that edge exceptionally hard, like an ancient warrior would have done, you know, that's why you're able to beat that other person.
I think that's really good advice, is that hard training. I've had a chance before all of this went down in the turn of the year here, to get some time in with Coach Randy and with you, in the caged area of the gym, and just do rounds, throwing ropes and hitting tires and doing sprawls. And I had a really good time, humbled by a lot of your guys. Your fight camp is tough by fitness standards, and you know the techniques they're running is classical, just pristine, good Jeet Kune Do. From my perspective, I'm a Wing Chun guy. I love Jeet Kune Do because it answers the questions that we had when we were first looking at Wing Chun. When it was first approached to me, I was like learning all the different ranges and what you could or couldn't do. And my Sifu at the time was just putting us into jujitsu chokes I didn't know anything about. And, you know, slaughtering us with that stuff. And we pick it up little by little. Later on, you realize that that's a whole nother subset. And I love that Jeet Kune Do takes you from the long range to the medium range to the short range and to the entire wealth of information on the ground. It's a complete system, missing only weaponry in that discussion, right? So weaponry is its own thing. Let's steer the conversation a little bit to your Kali and to your Kuntao. I don't want to let the podcast go too long, but I want to be able to cover this. We'll definitely, I want to do another one of these where we talk again and go deep into details, because you are an encyclopedia. I'd love to get some of that out of you. But let's talk a little bit about Kali and Kuntao and that Filipino fusion. And for anybody that was interested to train at home, what advice could you give those people?
Well, you know, Kali and Kuntao, I mean, unless you wanted to take it to the extreme of a fighter.
well, everybody's in it for self-defense.
Logical, you know? System for self-defense, both of them.
Right.
As far as I'm concerned, probably, to me, the best in the world. I mean, you know, it's not like I've trained other styles that I could see, but they cover a lot of area. On a martial art that covers weapons so deeply, like Kali and Kuntao does, to me, how could you beat that? You know, the weapon and both styles also translate to empty hand. And the thing is, I mean, when you've got a sharp object swinging at your neck, you know, and you could evade that. So a one-on-one fight is going to be nothing.
Absolutely.
You know?
Absolutely.
If, Filipino martial arts are multi-man attack oriented.
So you come from the mindset of the old systems, the traditional systems, which I definitely come to also. I started in Wing Chun. I got some jiu-jitsu. I met you and learned what my teacher was doing to me, which was Kuntao. And, of course, a blend. Maybe Kevin was doing some Sila as well. And I know there's a line between those two systems. And is it a cultural line, or is it, I mean, it's an ethnic line when you go for the naming, but the techniques and the positioning and the low fighting, the low stances, could you go into some history on some of that?
Well, the low stances, a lot of that, like I said, you know, before, when we were talking about discussion on how we were taking low positioning.
And
you know, you sit there for a while, you know, and it burns out the legs. It's really good for you because everything you do, whatever motion you do, I mean, you watch a Tai Chi guy, he gets in a low position and he does a movement like that.
There's so much footage of them. Yeah.
That's an off-balancing move.
Yeah.
A lot of Tai Chi people may not even know what it is, but, you know, because they just know the movements. But the same thing applies in Kung Tao. When you're in clinch range of some sort, or even in weapon range, you're taking a lower position, so you got to have those muscles developed.
Yeah.
So that's why the low positioning exists in so many of the Southeast Asian martial arts that you see, you know, the them practicing, and it might be boring. You see it a lot in Chinese martial arts.
Yeah.
And I've heard people make fun of it and say, "Gee, so yeah, I go to the class and he made me sit in the low four stance for you know, an hour."
Yeah.
Well, there's a reason for that. You know, I mean, one, it might be the teacher wanted to see if you were worthy of teaching at one time, I'm sure. Now they need the money, so they'll have you sit there for 5 minutes instead, yeah. You know.
The low stance work, I'm clicking between the views here. The low stance work is crucial for homework. Crucial.
Yeah. So you gotta do the homework on that. That's bottom line.
Yeah. I'd like to get into the discussion of just a little bit of some differentiators between Kali, Kung Tao, and Silat, because they are all in the melting pot of the islands, and they each get a different name, and they each get a different tone and flavor. So what you're doing, of course, is your own conclusion, and definitely the renaissance of what you've experienced, but built into a little cohesive system that you have passed on. Could you differentiate the three arts, if you would?
Kung Tao, the way I was taught, starts off empty hand. And from what I understand by meeting the Kung Taoists, the real Kung Taoists in the Philippines, not that my teacher wasn't a real Kung Taoist, I'm just saying,
yeah.
The actual Filipino Kung Taoists, they do. They start off with empty hand, then they teach the weapons. Kali starts right away with a weapon.
Right.
Depending on who you're learning from, the Silat from, but the Silat, pretty much starts off with the empty hand also.
Okay.
Now, I understand Kung Tao is one Chinese dialect and Silat is another Chinese dialect, an old Chinese dialect that also landed in Indonesia and southern Philippines.
Okay.
So Kung Tao landed there too. So that's probably two different Chinese groups that ended up in that area. I can be wrong on that, but this is from what I understand. That you know, the only difference is because there's a lot of things in all three that look very similar, and there's a lot of things in all three, depending on the style, that look completely different.
I've seen so many differences in Kung Tao, they all look different. Yeah, but yeah. Like in Silat,
I always use that quote, they all look the same but different.
Yeah,
you know, I've always said that.
You have some time also.
There's some takedowns that I've seen in Dumag. And I said, we do that in Kung Tao, but we don't do the same exact movement. You know, it's always, right now I'd like to show you in video, but
I know,
it's like I could show the same entry, but the end result is different.
And that's that does make them different. If you start to understand the arts, you can see that there's a stylistic difference that is also correlates with the culture. I understand you had some time with the Suwandas in terms of Silat. Was there any other influences other than Guru Dan and Asanto, where there's a little Silat vein with them? Is there anybody else in Silat that you had time with?
Well, I was lucky enough to do about four seminars with Herman Suwanda way back when. I was supposed to have, I took such a liking to him. He took a liking to me because I already had Kung Tao background.
Yeah.
And he saw that I was able to do his stuff a lot faster than the other people. So he used to pull me out and demonstrate with me and everything.
Nice.
Then I wanted to have him at my school. Unfortunately, what happened to him in Germany, that never happened. I saw a lot of things that were similar, again, but different. You know what I mean?
Yes.
So that was the thing with his system.
But that's good. Good confirmation for you to know that this is not Kung Tao like you saw this. However, they related. This is clearly another art form.
Would you say that's accurate? Yes. I mean, there's only so many ways you could hurt a body. So there's going to be some similarities in everything. I know a lot of karate schools, they just sit there and they do katas and they don't know the exact translation, but there's people that do. And I've been actually me and Eric Arroyo are doing about the same thing. Okay. We have been looking at these karate videos of old timers, and we've been texting back and forth. It's like, look at this and look at that. And you see, I mean, you see all the Kung Tao, like in Kali moves within old time karate.
Yes.
It's just that everybody got this vision of doing stiff and holding your hand out there while the guy's doing all his stuff around your body, you know? And so it's really hard to see it in more of the modern money-making schools, you might call it, you know?
In America, but, man, they have poured water all over it. Yeah.
Or an old film.
Yeah.
You see so many similarities, the angulating footwork, the way they step out at a 45, the way they do their quarter turns, the way they attack, you know, a lot of the strikes, a lot of the blocks that people are doing in karate has been mistranslated as blocks, and they're not even blocks because there's no way you could block a fast punch and come up and go like this. No. Those are strikes.
Yeah.
I mean, think of a move that, you know, when they come out, they punch and they go like this or something like that. That's, you know, maybe a strike could give you a finger jab, a palm or whatever, grabbing the collar. Or grabbing the wrist and then breaking the arm, you know, something like that. That's just, you know, hypothetical translation, yeah. But it's one of the things that I see.
Well, so I see in
just like the outside capture in Kung Tao, where we come in and we break the arm, or you think about Lop Sal and you break an arm.
Right.
You know,
right.
They're the same, but again, different. See?
Well, the movement, I want to just comment, the movement of actually bringing the arm back in so many of those forms is actually just that. And it's,
yes,
it's
exactly.
Cool that the kata
translates to an elbow structure.
Right.
That's another thing, you know?
Right. It's cool that the katas have meaning. And it's not cool that in so many institutions, the masters don't really have the full application, or maybe they know it in a textbook way, but then if you pair them up against, I'm going to just say anybody out of your Jeet Kune Do class that's got a year of training, they just say, okay, throw some boxing gloves on, fight this guy, see what happens. Your guy will slaughter them.
It's happened a lot, actually. I've had intermediate guys beat up black belts.
That is a testament. That is a testament to Jeet Kune Do and to, you know, functional martial arts. I'm sure Bruce Lee saw this, and I'm sure you guys who are all tracing that lineage are seeing it. And just, it's just an everyday for you to see somebody who's a karate guy who comes in. I say, oh, okay, here comes the karate guy. Let's see how he does. You know, man, he can't keep his hands up, or he doesn't move. He's too stiff, all these things. And it's not necessarily, maybe they just didn't spend enough time in their art to really become natural at it. But, I think there's too many.
It's translation.
It's translation. You need a good master to translate.
A lot of it is because, like I said, I'm not putting down karate. You got the true karate.
Yeah.
You got the people that have, like, you know, the Okinawan styles, the Japanese styles. I don't know much about the Korean styles, you know, very little, even though that was my first art back in the 60s.
Yeah.
But, you know, the thing is, they have a lot of these movements, which makes logical sense. If you have warriors going out there and fighting for you, you're not going to give them some sort of, you know, here, practice this kata like you see on Karate Kid, and you're going to get good enough to go into a tournament.
Yeah.
You know, that's not the way it is. You have to train and train this thing properly with all the proper angles and the proper positioning and the proper body structure to be able to put in power and evade the incoming strike at the same time.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah. So your time in Kung Tao and Kali and Sila and all the systems here, you can dice. I see it now, even as we're talking. You can look at an old form of any system and understand the technique. Like, what is it they're doing? Why does that movement look like that? They might be locked
sometimes
in.
Sometimes I try to translate it like that. Yeah.
Yeah, you must be able to do that easily. We're going to run out of time, but I want to talk about your Kung Tao book. That's something else that's on my list. And I wondered, was there any progress with that? any progress? Or maybe you can just share with our folks that you've got one on the horizon and
it is coming up. It will come up. As a matter of fact, now that we got downtime, I do have time to write. And now I'm down to almost to the point where all I need is the photos.
Nice.
Which I could probably get people, you know, either to come into my backyard. I already got told by a lot of the guys they want to do that. I do want to get some photos and stuff like that in there. And I got to do chapter at a time, though, because I've been trying to figure out how to, coordinate photos to the whole thing, and I was going to take all the photos and then try to figure out where they're going. I think that's not the way to do it. And you know, even if I categorize them, I'm going to have to do chapter at a time and do photos and then try to do it. So that's going to be
it's a big project.
Yeah, it's going to be a progress of work there. So I got to
horizon. It's on the horizon.
Yes. It's going to work. I've been not ignoring it. I just have so many projects going on, so many things going on between everything that I haven't been able to get to it. Besides when I go to the Philippines and, you know, I got a good 24 hours back and forth to write. You know, I just went to Thailand. Yeah. I did a lot. I accomplished a lot in the book. You know, now I accomplish a little bit, you know, I'll get a couple hours of writing or something like that. My eyes get crazy tired. For some reason, when I'm on the airplane, I could do it better than when I'm sitting down on the couch doing it, you know?
There's no distraction. I want to, because you're a specialist here, I want to go one last topic is the topic of traditionalfilipinoweapons.com. So those of you that are watching this and know anything about Ron's brand, I don't want to go too far into your secret sauce, but I do want people to understand that you have created a fantastic brand that is the sum of its parts here. Your catalog of weaponry spanning multiple cultures is very, very amazing and complete. And anybody who's a collector could spend their life's fortune and savings on getting all the pieces and putting them in beautiful stands. But you know, the site is up. You've got still good inventory. You are allowed to be in business, and so you're shipping. Tell us a little bit.
When I started off, I started off with a handshake with a friend out there that I saw that had karambits.
Nice.
And he gave me a box of karambits. I came home. I announced that this was back in the days prior to MySpace even, and I went on a few forums and I told people, I said, I got these karambits. Bam, they were gone. I swear, a box full of like, I think 20 of them was gone in, I think, within 2 weeks.
That's a hot knife. Back in that time, I remember getting into C-Lot and being like, man, those karambits are everything. They were really hard to find, good one.
Yeah, they were. Nobody was selling karambits back. That was another thing.
Yeah.
And if they were, they were selling the cheap ones that, you know, would get dull out really quick, you know?
Right, or they were plastic or something. That's
back then they were only made of the 5160. And now, you know, we've they've got a new trick where they powder D2 and they kind of add it as they're forging, and it seems to hold an edge even longer than our old ones do. It's built up slowly, and, you know, my friends were learning a different method of doing the steels as time went on, and it's evolved quite nicely now, where we can easily chop a tree down with a small sword, as I have online, probably in a few places, and you know, they do rather well. You know, that's the thing, and it is a good business. People are liking them.
Good. You have a Braveheart sword and a claymore and some really fantastic European swords I wish I had over my mantle. Tell us, so they were able to get a hardened steel and do some really high-tech metallurgy to be able to accomplish some of these longer, larger designs. Tell us about some of that.
Well, the technology, I mean, it's technology is technology. Some blade makers, anybody could be a knife maker nowadays, and so some don't believe the technology that I use. So they just got to look on traditionalfilipinoweapons.com and look at materials. They can see how it's done.
Right.
And I kind of explain it there.
You've got a little description there.
I do have people that argue with me about it, but, you know, that's because they don't know about it. But there are some that also know about it that tell me don't pay attention to them. The thing is, we started off with just Filipino weapons,
right,
as you know, and we had we started off with about probably 20 different Filipino weapons from north, south, and mid of the Visayan region, the mid-range, regions there. And people have been asking me to come out with other types of swords from other cultures. And so we started off with the kukri.
Yeah.
And came out with some European Scottish swords and We've got the Roman swords, some Celtic swords, and you know, the list goes on, and they're all badass.
Do you still have inventory? I'm sorry, and I don't want to interrupt. I'm bad at this. Do you still have inventory at the store with some of these non-Filipino blades? But like that are these things are weapons. You carry this. You leave this by your bed. You never feel afraid ever again. You wake up in the middle of the night, you know, somebody comes into your house, you happen to have a Celtic dress sword, and that was the wrong decision for them. What do you have in terms of inventory that you still got in some of those?
Yeah, I keep the inventory well-stocked. I try to anyway. Some things just sell so fast, it's hard to keep in stock.
Yeah.
Celtic swords is one of them. So is the Roman gladius. Those two are hard to keep in stock. The Ganunting is hard to keep in stock. The Giho sticks, which is Giho, is an ironwood from the Philippines. In ancient times, only in some islands they used the Giho. Now Giho, because it's such a popular wood to be able to make so many other things, they grow it in other islands now.
Okay.
But back then, it was only used in a few islands, and it's moderately hard. They call it not ironwood like Kamagong. If you hit something with Kamagong, there's a good chance it might break and shatter.
It's a brittle, or it's a dense wood that's kind of, I understand Kamagong will sink if you put it in water, whereas some of these other ones will float. Is that right?
I don't know. Giho won't float.
Okay.
I don't think any, Giho reminds me of a very hard version of like our cypress wood. Because they've actually, they've dug up wagon wheels in the Philippines that were there from the 1800s. They've found ships that they dug up that were made of Giho wood, whole ships almost, whole ship.
Wow.
I found them on the web, I saw it, that were around, and I think they date back to like the 1200s or something like that. So, you know, Giho, that's why I say it reminds me of our cypress wood, because it just kind of, it could sit there and not rot, you know. They used to use cypress for gutters down south, I know, at one time. Now it's against the law to do that type of thing. But, you know, it's a wood that could, you know, take the weathering. That's the thing. So Giho makes a beautiful weapon. It'll definitely, when you crack somebody, wherever you crack them with, you're going to break that area.
That's amazing. And
especially the design, you know, it shouldn't be round. Round is more for, I think, the tourist attractions, you know, to represent like the Kali sticks, but the octagon or hexagon shapes that they are. Oh my God! You know, you get hit with that, bam! It breaks. Whatever hits, you know.
Yeah, so you can't keep that in stock. You're saying those are really hot sellers.
Yes, those things they go. It's hard to keep them in stock. In fact, I think I got. I don't know if I have one left. No, I don't. I don't even have one left. I just sold out my last one, I think, yesterday, as a matter of fact, and I had 100 of them.
Wow. So as a substitute, though, you've got a patent pending way of doing Kali sticks that makes them very dense. And anybody that's at home that wants to be able to train and have a great pair of training sticks, you've always had a great reputation of having great, great sticks. So maybe that's a plan B for them. They could get a set of what you carry for Kali sticks. Do you still guys
have inventory on that? Kali sticks are also like, it's hard to keep in stock. I basically sell them right out of the oil because I got to make them. It's a 5-week process. Within that 5 weeks, I sold the last batch that I oiled. So I'm actually, when they arrive to people, they have to use like olive oil and wipe off the sawdust because I actually roll them in sawdust.
Nice.
And then I wrap them up and I send them to the people because if I don't roll them in sawdust, the package will be soaked in oil.
Understood.
You know, so it's like I use the sawdust to absorb it for them so that it's not a mess when it gets there. And then it's just easy to clean off the sawdust.
Yeah. So that's an example of some really, really nice handmade, products that you feature within the TFW brand, some of the Kali sticks. That's definitely got to be a staple for a lot of gyms and for a lot of practitioners. They must, if they've got a partner or they're hitting a tree or something, they must be going through sticks. And so that's nice. And the stick was always meant to be the representation of the blade. It was how you trained the blade and kept your training partner safe and worked your grip. And if you made a mistake, it's not a blade. So you'll be okay. You get cracked with a stick, you'll live.
Yes, yes. That's the thing. So sticks, the Kali sticks, contrary to popular belief, they're not weapons. They're actually training weapons that are used actually throughout Southeast Asia to represent either their ancient method of impact weapons or the swords. So you use it two different ways. Sometimes you just hit, and sometimes you hit and slice, you know, kind of like a semi-slicing, like hacking motion, you know. So it depends on what you want to practice for, you know.
Yeah. Now, that's you also cool. carry, we're going to run out of time, but you also carry some ABS preformed designs. You've got some, if I remember right, some bolos, some gununtings, some karambits. Tell us a little bit of some of those plastic trainers. Those are really nice.
Yeah, we got a lot of training weapons, from staff sticks to swords. We got the barong, the espada y daga.
In a training design,
training, you know, of course, training knives, you know, different various sizes. And I even, I don't make these or anything, but there's a folder we have actually that a company makes. And I like it so much because, you know, you got to practice. Everybody carries a folder. So for self-defense purposes, you know, we have them, you know, we might even have them sparring a little bit and then going for the knife. And you have to get that reaction to, you know, see that he's going for a knife either in his pocket, in the back of him, or in the front, in the, you know, in his belt clip or something like that. So it's good to have that kind of knife also. So we we try to cover all the self-defense. I was thinking of putting a video out also using that folder someday, you know, to show how we do it anyway, you know.
Yeah, well, there is an art form of getting to your knife, so part of the movements and the masking and the chambering is actually to pull the blade out. I understand, is that, that's part of that?
Yeah, right? You have to be able to prevent it. And yes, if you carry a knife and you got two or three guys around you, you have to be able to get to that weapon.
Yeah,
and that's one of my specialty areas that I teach people, is to be able to get to your gun and to be able to get to your knife if need be. You know, a lot of people, you know, like you must have heard it too. People come up to you and say, "Well, what are you going to do against 357? What's martial arts going to do?"
Understood. Yeah.
You go up to a person, you put them a knife to his throat, say, "What are you going to do with your 357 right now?" Right. You know,
right.
And that's the thing. You know, you're walking down the street with your wife or kids, and somebody comes up behind you and sticks a knife to your back or something. You know, you got to protect your kids. You got to protect yourself and be able to get to your weapon, because your gun ain't going to do shit for you if you can't do something about it.
They're already on you. And
you got to know how to get out of those situations, get your kids or your wife, you know, out of that situation, and, you know, get to your weapon so you could counter what he's doing to you, you know?
Yeah. Awareness is such a big part of the training of a regular martial artist has, I think, heightened awareness. And it's something that I always, really appreciated, having gone through a journey and seen a lot of styles, is that me as a person training this stuff, I really enjoyed my heightened sense of awareness. I feel like an upgrade when I started in Kung Tao, because immediately you started to think about, well, what if I have to fight three people or five people or the whole room? What am I going to do? What technique should I use? How do I get out of there? How do I manage this situation? What are my options? What are my techniques? And the Kung Tao really opened me up to seeing, like, now I would go into a room or be in a restaurant or a bar, and I'd say, well, actually, I want to sit here so I can see who comes in. And you get to analyze.
That helps.
You know?
Environmental awareness is step one.
Step one. Step one. Getting to your weapon, step two. All those things are part of that, that
environmental
lifestyle.
Environmental weapons. Don't forget environmental weapons.
Yeah.
You know, anything in a restaurant, you know, the chair. You know, we used to say the ashtray, but nobody keeps an ashtray in the restaurants anymore.
yeah, right. It's a timepiece.
But anything, actually, you know, so, you know, could be used, you know, whatever you see that's laying around can be used. Spitting is one of your environmental weapons. You spit into his face, you know, as soon as he goes like that, you know, you kick and you enter, you know.
Yeah.
Around him, use him as a shield now, you know. So there's a lot of different methods now that to think of, you know, within our Kung Tao system that I thought Joe Rossi did an excellent job when he brought this style to the United States, you know?
Yeah. So do you try to, when you take a student in, do you try to give them a similar experience like what you got when you first walked in? I know I try to take each person and take them from wherever they're at, but I really do want to kind of say, okay, well, welcome, but you're going into this box because that's the first box everybody gets. Did you have that experience in Mr. Rossi's class? I'd love to go back and maybe finish this interview, and in this might be our last topic, where we talk just a little bit about your early days and how that influenced the way you teach. Do you like to take a person in a very specific way, the way you were brought in? Tell us.
Well, I mean, I start everybody off from the beginning and show them what's going on. You know, usually when somebody tries out a class, they fall into the sequence of the class because, you know, I'm not going to teach them all the beginning stuff. It's probably going to bore them. But I do explain to them that there's a step-by-step process to be able to get to, you know, a more advanced level. You can't get down to fighting because, you know, there's a certain way to finger jab the eyes, a certain position of the body to finger jab the eyes. Right. You know what I mean? There's ways to use your hips. There's ways to use your shoulders. There's a way to headbutt, you know.
We could have conversations about all this.
I have to take a person to the side and actually show them. I actually use the Wing Chun dummies.
Oh, nice.
Just because there's certain movements of the hands and stuff like that that I like to show and use the dummy to kind of, give them a sense of, how to angle, you know, once they learn how to do it, how to angle with it, how to step, and, you know, the 50-50 weight distribution, and, you know, and then I go into striking off of it. You know, I feel like I invented a dummy form with using Kuntao.
Yeah, well, I mean, many styles use that dummy as a way to train when they're at home. Like right now, I have a dummy here in my office that I built out of PVC. I bought arms probably 2 or 3 years ago, and I finally put the thing together, you know, and here it is next to me, and I am using it every day. And we almost ought to do episode 1.2 here, where you and maybe me too would go and give folks a little bit of an exercise they could do to get some basics while they're under quarantine, while they're stuck at home. If they had a dummy, or even actually if you have just a pole or a tree, you have at least one center line of something you can kind of whack into. There's got to be drills you could give folks.
Even, you know, if you had to, just to simulate. Right now, it's really hard. Playing by yourself in martial arts is difficult because, I mean, you need a resisting partner.
You do.
You know, martial arts. In fact, all the martial arts that I do, you need a resisting partner. Unfortunately, I don't have forms. So it's in any of the styles that I do. There are things that I could, you know, give you to get a form going, you know, of course.
Yeah.
But,
well,
you know,
I think a form is just shadow boxing in the air, but picking a sequence. Maybe it would be a technique. In Jeet Kune Do, it would be a jab, cross, hook, uppercut, tie kick, clinch, elbow, throw down, grappling, sprawl. I mean, you could invent the invisible opponent on a sequence, and that's form one. You could just make them up. If you didn't have forms in a formal way, which doesn't, and many of the systems don't have, so you can just shadow fight. Right, there's still value in that.
Yeah. I do have guys. I told them to shadow box, you know, of course, in the shadow box and act like somebody's shooting on you and sprawl, things like that, you know. And you know, I mean, that's right now the guys who want to fight, they're trying to train at home. They're doing the best they can.
Yeah,
you know. So I mean, this is all they could do right now is, you know, I know Randy actually broke down and gathered a few of the guys and, you know, and had them hit the mitts and stuff like that.
Nice.
That can be dangerous. However, those guys have been sitting home, you know, doing nothing. So I doubt they're sick at all. You know, doing nothing. And then, you know, they got together a few times, but
I think there's no danger if people have all, like, I've been quarantined here for 30 plus days. I didn't leave. I've never left except to just go outside and do yard work. Go to the store once in a 2 week, 3 week period. I'm all masked up and gloved up using hand sanitizer just to be safe. There's no danger for those of us that have been quarantined. I feel like some of us can get back together. So maybe in my next episode, we do a face-to-face and film us practicing. I think people will really enjoy that. What do you think about that?
Yeah.
I trust you.
That would be good. Yeah, that would be cool, you know, to be able to do something and maybe teach. It's hard to do, though, you know, like, even my wife, she's not a martial artist, you know, she does all the healing stuff. So it's, you know, that's like, you know, her trying to do a healing massage and teaching it by herself, you know. Well, she could use me on that.
Yeah.
With me with martial arts, doing something that I'm afraid I'm going to break her with, you know.
Yeah, well.
Even doing full motion, you know.
Yeah.
You don't get the full effect on it when I grab her and, you know, say, you know, I'm trying to, you know, show a move and, you know, she doesn't react, you know, she, you know, or afraid of the move that I'm doing or something,
right.
You know, so it's a little, a little different, you know.
It's hard.
She didn't do futile with me, but, you know, right now she's so busy with the healing stuff. And
yeah. Let's plug her real quick. Let's plug her. Let's go down the list of the things that you're involved with and maybe close on some of this. But so if anybody's interested in his wife and her healing modalities, I know she has a website. That's AllysEarthTreasures.com.
Yes.
And she spells it
A-L-L-Y-S. Okay. And then earthtreasures.com.
And she's got, I know I have one of her beanbag heat packs, but she's got a bunch of oils and stuff that are amazing, right? What else does she sell?
Oh, she's got a pain oil, which is amazing. And I'll tell you, a CBD usually never worked on me, the oil outside, you know, and when you put it on externally, I mean.
Okay.
I have vapes of CBD, and it lasts, maybe takes the pain away for about a half an hour to an hour on my back. I've got something going on with my back that's really bad, you know?
Yeah.
And puts this pain oil on. I swear, I'm good for a couple of days. I can't even believe it. You know, like I said, I went for that bike ride. That morning, she put it on, and I thought, oh boy, there goes my back tonight.
Yeah.
I'm still okay. Even today, and I went for that back ride yesterday.
Well, tell us. So she has that product available. She has that product available on the store. You can get something like that because you sound like an advocate, and we're all once in a while we're injured or we got some training pains. What's the name of that oil?
It's called Pain Away, I think it's called, right? I think it's or Ouchies. No, it's called Ouchies.
Ouchies.
That's what she calls it. Yeah, yeah.
I like that.
So yeah, that's her humor. In the way she kind of names things, you know, like her lip balm that she has. A lot of people, you know, a lot of people use all kinds of products. Everybody's claiming on this lip balm, this is the only thing that they ever use that worked. She calls it crack attack.
Crack.
You know?
Well, so, a lot of times.
Humor like me, so.
Yeah, a lot of times people would need a chapstick.
She kind of like names these things that, you know, by what she pops in her head, kind of, you know?
Yeah.
And it works. I don't know if the oil is on her her website yet. I think she's waiting. It might be. I'm not sure.
Okay.
But if there's things on there that they want that she might not be on the website, they could look for her on Facebook. And it's like Allison Fan Kazakowski. Just look that up on Facebook.
Okay.
Allison spelled with one L, A-L-A-S-O-N. And then my name, you know, my last name. And, you know, you can look her up on Facebook and ask her if she has this or whatever. She puts a lot of stuff on her Facebook. It seems like she sells more off of Facebook than she does on her website, but
yeah,
it's working.
Well, that's a great plug. Hopefully she'll have some interest in that. And so then we'll go down the list. We were talking earlier about traditionalfilipinoweapons.com. You can search that on Google if you don't know how to spell it, but we like to spell it Filipino with an F.
Yes, okay. Yes. That's what it's proper. I don't know why Philippines is spelled with PH and Filipino is spelled with an F. I don't know, but
okay,
that is, you that's know, the, that's the
is. Spelling with an F is doing a justice to the Filipino people, right?
Yep.
Okay. And then also, of course, the school is gearing back up. You still got the institution. And if anybody was interested to read up on classes, are you in a place where you would do video conferences with people if they had that interest? They want to do some private time with you?
We can, I guess, you know, I could give them the beginning aspects of Kali, how to swing an actual weapon. That would be one thing if it came down to that, you know, if people are interested. I do, it was a work in progress just before the virus came up. We were talking about the video program that I want to do online, which I'm going to do a video course on. I'm going to start off with Kali. And maybe move into Kuntao. I don't know yet. And, you know, I do want to do a course with my son on the Jeet Kune Do also and get some things going with that. And, you know, do a thing where people could learn from me. And if they want to get certified, I could have workshops with the people that do want to get fine-tuned and get eventually certified in these styles with me.
Yeah.
You know, so this way I could get students all over the world, I guess, if they want to do that. You know,
you've got a history of doing
progress, you know, like I said, it was a work in progress, but you know, once the virus hit, it just seemed like it was, you know, it's everybody's afraid to get together and do things now, and I do need people to make these videos right now.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, it's a true story. Well, but you know what? To a positive, because I know it will come out because you're a guy that gets things done. You are the best martial artist you've ever been right now because of what's going on up top, right? It's all
the juices. I got more knowledge than I used to have. Yeah.
Yeah. You're the best you've ever been.
Then what I know now.
Yeah. I always say that to people and I say it about myself because I want to, it's good to have a little confidence. We are right now the best we've ever been. And all we can do is try to be better than we were yesterday, right?
Yes. So I mean, you got to keep learning.
Yeah.
You know, I keep learning. I still go to seminars when I can. I still do a private lesson when I can.
Yeah.
You know, I met some catch wrestling people. I went to Mike Martell recently. You know, a couple years ago, I brought Jesse up to work with Eric Paulson.
Yes.
I even got working. I mean, I couldn't believe I'm still learning. I mean, he's a freaking encyclopedia anyway.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I learned a lot more from him and I couldn't believe it. Stuff that I've never seen before. So that worked out well. I still see, you know, Guru Dan when I can, you know, when things are going anyway. And whoever I could work with, I still work with, you know, it's not like I stopped learning either. You know, there's a world of information. How to hold on to all that information, that's another story.
You got to practice it. You got to practice it. I always say this, that if I always say, man, I wish I could go back in time and start over, but you know, I'd like to be as good as I am now, but I'd like to go back to the beginning. And actually it dawned on me teaching my kids is that every time you get a new student, brand new, you start your system over again. So there is a gift that the student gives to the master, which is that we get to start over. We get to be a student again.
That's the good thing about teaching.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. Well, I'm going to call it. I'm going to hit the end record button in just a minute. Thank you for giving me so much of your morning and for sharing.
Yeah, thank you very much. This is good. Yes. Thank you.
If anybody wants more information about what I'm doing, we're going to put credits in the bottom of the video. But thank you for watching and we'll see you another time. 3, 2, 1. Yeah.